coming back to the start, where you found me. I'm coming back to your heart. I surrender. Take me. This is all I can do.
Thank you.
till I made you.
Yes, Lord.
I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I made you. Exhausted, you will be my strength. When my mind says I'm not good enough, God, you're enough for me. I've decided I'm not giving up, 'cause you won't give up on me. You won't give up on me. Your love is strong enough and it won't let go. I feel it. Church, your love is all alone and it won't let go.
season, you keep repeating your promises to me. Now there's no stopping what you have started until it is complete. When my mind says I'm not good enough, God, you're enough for me. And I decided I'm not giving up, 'cause you won't give up on me. You won't give up on me.
Place zero with break our walls down. Spirit, break out. Heaven, come. Holy Spirit, Spirit, break out.
Break our walls down.
Break our walls down. Spirit, break out. Heaven, come down. Holy Spirit, Spirit, break out. Break our walls down. Yeah. Spirit, break out.
First-time visitors in the house of God tonight, go ahead and just lift your hand up. I'm not going to embarrass you or anything or call you up to the front. I just want to acknowledge that you're here. Okay, nobody. All right, praise God. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to direct this to the online viewers. If this is your first time online, okay, if this is your first time watching us online, we would like to connect with you here at Word of Life. So what we want you to do is we want you to pull your cell phone out, okay, wherever you are. If you're at home, if you're in the car, don't do it. You can't text and drive. But pull your cell phone out, okay, and text WELCOME to 619-404-2795. If you're an out-of-town visitor and you're watching us and you're out of town, we would also like to connect with you. So go ahead and text OOT to that same number, 619-404-2795. Now, if you would like to be updated on events that goes on here at Word of Life, go ahead and text the word LOOP, okay? It's going to be L-O-O-P to 619-404-2795. 404-2795. Amen. Now go ahead and focus your attention to the big screen for ways to give.
Your financial giving is what keeps this ministry alive and able to spread the gospel all over the world. Through your giving, we've been able to support everything that happens in-house here in La Mesa, as well as our churches scattered all over San Diego County and all over the world, like Fiji and the Philippines. So thank you for that. If you need some instructions on where to give, this is the place to be. If you have checks, you can actually mail those checks in to our church offices. But if you have cash, we ask that you drop that off in person. So you can bring your cash and checks to our church offices. Just call ahead of time to make sure that somebody is in the office to receive your offering. You can also use our online options. PayPal is available through our website, WLWC.org. We also have Venmo, though. That is an electronic app that you can use right on your phone. It's actually fee-free and very easy to use. So if you need more instruction on how to download Venmo, visit us in the Welcome Center. We'll be able to help you out. We also have in-house giving. So if you're here during one of our service times, you can, of course, drop that offering off in the basket that's centered at the back of the service, only available after service so that we can maintain proper social distancing and minimize the passing of those baskets and make sure that you are safe and healthy. We also have a safety deposit box, which can be accessed anytime the church doors are open. So that's during our Wednesday night services, 7 p.m., or our Sunday morning services at 10 a.m., as well as during our food pantry on Tuesdays and Fridays. Our food pantry is open, like I said, Tuesdays and Fridays from 10 to 11:30 a.m. You're more than welcome to visit us anytime to drop off your offerings, as well as visit our food pantry so that you can reap a blessing of some free food. You can also visit our Florence's Market on Sundays, select Sundays. So make sure you listen to the announcements so you know when it's open.
Amen, amen, hallelujah. So tonight I have the privilege of bringing up tonight's tithes and offering teaching. So we're just gonna go right into it, okay? We're starting off with 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6 through 8, and we're doing it in the King James Version, okay? So we're gonna start it off. Verse 6 says, "But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall also reap sparingly. And he which soweth bountifully shall also reap bountifully." For everybody who's giving into this ministry, I just wanted to encourage you to continue to give, because as you give into this ministry, you are supporting the ministry. And in return, we go out and we support other ministries. Also, we have faithful and obedient pastors that are faithful and obedient with the finances. Amen? Verse 7 says, "Every man according as he purposed in his heart, let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver." So I wanted to speak from an experience that we all can relate to, right? Each and every one of us, we've been a child before, right? Whether we're an adult, take it, we have children in the house of God tonight. Praise God. So each of us, we've been a child before, right? And I want to speak from that experience, because as a child, we all used to go and play on the playground, hopefully. Hopefully nobody was bullied. If you were, praise God. Jesus still loves you. But look, on the playground, as playing on the playground as a child, there was always this excitement feeling that stirred up on the inside of you. There was always this joy and this cheer that bubbled up on the inside of you as a child going to play on the playground. Now get this, as children of God, we are not on a playground anymore, more like a battlefield, but we are on holy ground. We are on holy ground, so how much more excited shall we be as children of God giving on God's holy ground? Amen. So the verse says that God loves a cheerful giver. Now, As I read that scripture, I began to think, well, God already loves me, so why does it say that God loves a cheerful giver? And God does love us, and his love is unfailing, right? But as we give in the realm of cheerfulness, it brings pleasure to our Father that's in heaven. It brings him pleasure. And then what happens after we give in the realm of cheerfulness and we give God pleasure? It says in verse 8, listen to this. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye always having all sufficiency in all things may abound in every good work. So, in bringing God pleasure to our Father, by generously giving on God's holy ground opens up the door for his abundant provision to enter in abundantly. Let us pray. Father God, I just thank you, Lord. I thank you for everybody that is giving into this ministry. Father God, I thank you for the leaders and the pastors that are obedient with the finances. And I ask you, Lord, that you continue to open up the wells of heaven, Father, and pour out your spiritual and financial blessings over this ministry and over this church, Father. I ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for joining us online. Here is Pastor Miller.
Praise God. Let's stand on our feet just for one moment. Man, it was so cold. You know, when I was in Nepal, they gave me this thing in Nepal. This is one of these Nepalian scarves, you know. And I thought, man, this would be pretty warm. And it was really nice, but in here it's hot. Praise the Lord. Are you having a good day? Did you have a good day? Were you blessed? Oh, praise the Lord. You know, every day is a good day. Every day is the day the Lord has made, and we rejoice. Someone said once, they said, man, I don't like it when it rains because it's so gloomy and so dark, the sun doesn't shine. But I want you to know something. The sun shines all the time. All you got to do is get above the circumstances. Did you hear what I said? Get above your circumstances. And how do you get above your circumstances? You get above the circumstances by focusing on the Lord in the midst of your battle. Amen? Father, we bless you. We thank you for another day that is your day. We thank you, Father God, for the privilege and the honor to be gathered together in your name. We thank you for America, that we can do this, that we can gather together and be together and assemble together because you said you are in the midst where there are two or three gathered together. And you told us, Lord, to do this, not to forsake our assembling together. And so, Lord, we stand on not only our rights that you've given us, but on of our constitutional rights that we have in this great nation of America. We thank you for this land. We pray for this land. It's sick tonight, Lord. And we pray for America that you would restore, that you would be with the pastors and the leaders in this city who are struggling and who are troubled, and their congregations, their churches are battling. And Father God, I pray for those Christians that are weak and fearful, that they would not have fear, but they would have faith and put boldness to their faith. I pray for God, those who have stumbled and lost their way during this time, during this journey, they have gotten discouraged and have left the faith and become so confused and so suicidal. I pray, God, protect them. Put your hand around about them. Restore them and restore the joy of your salvation back inside of their lives. We pray, Lord, for these things, God. We ask, God, desperately for all of these churches and places. We pray for our dear pastor of the Journey Church, that you be with him and strengthen him and encourage his faith and encourage his heart. Even tonight, God, that he would not allow the circumstances that he's dealing with and going through to overcome him, that he would overcome by the blood of the Lamb. Now, Lord, we pray not only for the churches in this city, but we pray for the churches in our fellowship. We pray for all of our ministries and all of our Word of Life churches around the world. We pray, Father God, for Praise Chapels, God, and we pray, Father God, for In the Light Ministries, and we pray, Father, for the Assemblies of God, and we pray for those, God, at the Calvary Chapels. We pray, God, that you bless those pastors and be with them as we together are battling the battle of our freedom. We thank you, Father God, for men and women who are willing to stand in a hard time and stand in a time of difficulty and stand in a time of controversy. And Father, we stand boldly because you have not given us the spirit of fear, but the spirit of power, love, and of a soundness of mind. Therefore, we hold no fear For fear hath torment, but perfect love, you said, look, cast out fear. We cast it out in the name of Jesus. And we stand in the word of Almighty God. Amen. In Jesus' name. Come on, let's give God praise. Give God glory. You can be seated. Praise the Lord. Starting this Sunday, everybody say this Sunday, we're going back to normal offering taking. Okay? And now, if you still have a little reservation there, you can hold on to it and do it the way you're doing it. And those of you that are watching online, you can still do yours the way you want to do it. But we want to get everything back into its normalcy. And how many believe God? Amen. Amen. And so we're thanking God for that. And then also tomorrow at 11 a.m., if you are able to come, if you want to come, we're going to be having the celebration of life of Sister Kim Francis right here at 11 a.m. We're going to celebrate her life. We're so sad that she has departed. But we know it's all in the timing and the planning of God, and therefore we want to continue to pray for her family, her sons, and her daughter. And we just pray that God would just strengthen and encourage them. Amen? Amen. 11 a.m. tomorrow morning right here at Word of Life Worship Center. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. How many of you are ready to hear the word of the Lord? Hallelujah. All right. Come on. I want to preach about the Lord, our deliverer. And the reason I wanted to preach on that is because I want you to have a focal point by which you look to the Lord and understand, because, you know, many people say, well, Jesus is my Savior. He is your Savior. But he is also the baptizer of the Holy Ghost. He's also the healer of the body. He's also the deliverer. He's also the provider. He's also our rock. He's also our bread of heaven. He's also our living water. He's our Savior. He's our fire. Amen. He's our victory. He's our power. He's our faith. He's our come. In other words, Jesus is everything, and we have to really have a focal point when we get into trouble, when we go through a storm, when we go through a battle. We have to see the ending of that storm. How many felt that and heard that thunder today and felt that rain today, and it was like really, really pouring down? And you, as you look out, like my wife and I were looking out in the backyard, and we're seeing the water gather. You know, we're thinking how much more water would gather before it starts coming inside, you know. And so we often look at things like that and wonder, is this going to stop or is it going to accelerate? You see, and when we go through a battle, we often sometimes wonder if it's going to stop or is it going to accelerate. And what we have to do is understand, in the midst of a storm, we can see by faith that it's going to end. That God somehow is going to end that thing, and it's not going to be the thing that takes us out. Can I hear somebody say amen? Amen. Amen. I know recently if you got a little sneeze, a little cough, you're thinking, my God, I got the COVID. I'm in trouble. No, you made it through it. Amen. Those of you who had the COVID and you made it through it, and those who didn't have the COVID or you didn't think you had it, anyway, you had it. Amen. And if you were here, you had it. Glory to God. Somewhere, if you were near anybody in Costco or in Walmart, you had it. Amen. You know, all the people in Walmart had it. You can see them walking around. They had it. And it's okay. You survived it. But Pastor, what about those who didn't? Well, those who didn't survive it, there's two things that we have to understand about battles and storms. That those who didn't survive it had a number of things called underlying conditions. But even those with underlying conditions still survived it. But there were those who had underlying conditions who didn't survive it. That's their time. You understand that? So the devil wants to get you out of focus and think that somehow there's something's happened in the atmosphere and God's word does not work anymore and this thing is by luck and chance. No, sir, no, ma'am. The word of God will not pass away. Heaven and earth will pass away before the word of God pass away. And we know that it's by the timing of God that these people have departed. And they have departed not because they got something, but this was something through which God took them out. Hello? You know, it's like you could be the best driver in the world, but all of a sudden somebody else hits you and takes you out. You see, the Word of God teaches us that we have to stay focused, particularly in a storm, particularly in a battle, because if not, we can become disillusioned by things we do not clearly see and clearly understand. And the church world, God has taught us principle after principles how to stay focused on the things that are important and how to not get distracted by the things that are not important. You know, how many know the our world works that way? You can always bet if there's some major thing happening in the world, there's something else is going on behind the scenes. If the news media really targets something, you can always stop looking at that. There's something else going on behind the scenes. And as a pastor and as your leader, I have to always kind of give these forefront things dealing with our world we live in, because we do live in a world that does not allow us to be separated as a church. We need to begin to pray. Let me say it again. We need to begin to pray against these bills that they're trying to get of Equality Act. Because this is about taking the rights from women. It's about taking your children's rights. It's about taking the pulpit's right. It's about saying, if I say the name of Jesus, or if I preach against any wickedness or homosexuality or intermarital wickedness or any type of living together, then I have broken a federal law and I go to prison. And Christians want to put their head in the sand and not be focused on what's really happening, because what they have in their heart and mind is Jesus is coming. And I believe that. But the question is, what if he doesn't come next month? What if it doesn't come next year? We have to stay focused and understand, one, that we are in a battle. Two, the battle is real. And three, we already won if we stay focused. All right, so let's look at the Word of God, the book of Hebrews. Turn with me in the book of Hebrews. In the 12th chapter, starting with verse 1 and verse 2, and I'm going to build my case with you tonight, and hopefully you can walk out of here with a greater depth of understanding of what God is doing and why he is our deliverer. Amen. The book of Hebrews, chapter 12, verse 1, the Bible says, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight that does so easily beset us, and run with patience the race that is set before us." He tells us to lay aside every weight that is so easily besets us, so easily distracts us, so easily allows us to get our eyes off of two things, the focal point and the prize. The Bible teaches us that we are to have a focal point in life where we look at what we look at and who we look at, so that we can stay focused in the midst of our storms. Because the moment you take your eyes off of the focal point, the moment you take your eyes off Jesus, you begin to become distracted with the world and distracted with problems and distracted with fears. And so the Word of God teaches us in verse 2, he tells us, looking unto Jesus. The Bible teaches us that we're to look to Jesus. Now, this looking to Jesus is not just looking at Jesus, but looking through Jesus for the victory, looking through Jesus for the healing, looking through Jesus for the deliverance. And so he says, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith. Do I have anybody here that can believe that and say amen, that Jesus is the author and finisher of my faith? When we became Christians, we first became Christians, we looked to Jesus as Savior. We said, Lord, I'm looking to Jesus. You know, the problem with you, young man, you need to let Jesus come into your life. If somebody ever told you that, you need to let Jesus come into your heart. Well, what happens is when we look to Jesus, we let Jesus come in. We look to him that he is the one and the only one that can save us from sin. Jesus said he's the door, he's the way, the truth, and the life, and he's the door by which if any man enter in, they will enter in. So we always point people to look to the Savior, that Jesus Christ can save you if you look to the Savior. Now, what happens is that's a great experience. We experience that, but if we're not careful, even as a weak Christian, a young Christian, we can go through trials and battles, and we begin to take our eyes off Jesus, and we begin to look at what we're dealing with now, and all of a sudden, Jesus is no longer the focal point of our life, but now the problem is our focal point, and we put more faith in the trouble, more faith in the fear than we do in Jesus Christ. How many know if Jesus got you, nobody can get you? Did you hear that? If Jesus got you, nobody can get you. He said, no man will pluck you out of my Father's hand. So we have to understand this and understand that no matter what happens around the world, no matter what happens in the political geosystem of this world, we are looking to Jesus Christ. We are waiting for him. And I want you to know something. Let me give you something. I think the Holy Spirit, I sense the Holy Spirit. He wants me to give this to you. Let me give this to you, that you're not to be focused too much about too much politics. You know, because a lot of times, if we're not careful, we start looking to politicians to help us instead of Jesus Christ to help us. And then we begin to look at all the problems we have, and we begin to say, well, maybe the Antichrist, maybe the world is coming to an end, and blah, 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 blah. Well, there's a lot of things that are going to happen. There's a lot of rumors that are going to happen. A lot of things are going to happen before the end comes. Jesus said, but the end won't be yet. But what he didn't tell us here is in the midst between looking at this point of trouble and the beginning of sorrows and in the book of Matthew 24th chapter, as we begin to look at that, he is referring to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. He is referring to the second coming when he returns from heaven to the earth, touches his foot inside of the graveyard hill in Jerusalem and goes through the eastern gate. And that's a wonderful thing because we see the events of the scripture and we see the events of our world pointing to that. What we do not see in the midst of what we're seeing today is that Jesus is coming before that event for his church. And there are not necessarily any signs of his coming for the church, except he gives a warning. He says there are 10 virgins, 5 foolish and 5 unwise. He says, you keep yourself lit with the fire of God. You stay ready because you don't know. No man knows the hour. No man knows the day when Jesus will come. So Jesus could come next week. But his second coming is not necessarily until these events take place. So don't be focused on that and thinking, well, we haven't seen that yet and we won't see the Antichrist. You're absolutely right. You're not going to see the Antichrist unless you get stuck here. If you get stuck here, it's because you took your eyes off Jesus. And you got focused on your problem. You put more faith in man than you put in God. So we have to stay focused because we do not have an indication. Let me say it again. We do not have an indication when Jesus could snatch the church away. The only indication in Scripture, in Matthew, in Matthew 24, is the indication of the things that are coming, rumors and wars and rumors of battles and troubles and sorrows and all types of things, abominations and all types of desolations. We see that happening now. But this is referring to the coming of the Lord Jesus when he actually physically comes to the earth and puts his foot down. But there are no indications except the warning of be ready. So let me just encourage you with that. Just stay ready. Don't focus on the problems. You're worrying about problems. You're worrying about how you're going to pay your mortgage, how you're going to pay your rent, what you're going to do, how you're going to get your next paycheck. And who knows, tomorrow you may be gone. So the word of God teaches us, he says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross. He endured the cross. Now, why did the scripture say that for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. The Bible says he endured the cross, despising the shame. Why did Jesus endure the cross? How did Jesus endure the cross? And the question even is, why did Jesus endure the cross? Why did he despise the shame? Because he said it is set down at the right hand of God, right hand of the throne of God. He endured the cross for the joy of knowing that what he was going to give ultimately was his life, that he would redeem all of humanity and every man and every woman and every boy and girl, despite what he had to go through, would have the greatest opportunity in the whole life, in the universe of your life, you'd have an opportunity to be with him in heaven. Aren't you? Come on, give Jesus a praise for that. Let's thank Jesus for his salvation. Thank God for his salvation. So the scripture goes on. It tells us that no matter what we go through, no matter who we face throughout life, we must continue. We must not be distracted. We must continue to focus our vision and our focal point. The focal point is the place where your lens comes. It can see something, but then somehow you have to. You can often see something. You have these modern cameras. You can take a photograph of someone, but behind them, the background is blurred. You can reverse that and get the background in focus, but the person that's forefront is blurred. And what the Word of God is teaching us, that we are looking at Jesus at the same time we're looking at life. And we need to not look past Jesus. Oh, come on, somebody. We need to look at Jesus. That means we need to pull our lens back instead of looking at the problems behind Jesus and the problems that are coming. We need to pull our lens back and get them tightly focused on Jesus and keep looking to Jesus, because the Bible says he is the author, he is the finisher of our faith. Hallelujah. So the Word of God teaches us this. Now, you understand what happened with Peter. Peter got out of the boat and he walked on the water because he asked Jesus. Jesus told him to come. The Bible says Peter walked on the water until he took his eyes off Jesus and he began to look at the waves and the wind. Did you hear what I just said? He took his eyes off Jesus. How many know in a time of great stress, and this is what the church is under, this is what the world is under, all the nations in the world are working together to bring in what we Christians know is the one world government. And that stress on us, man, we're stressed out about this. I don't want to take the mark of the beast. And we're stressing over something that we don't really have to stress over, because Jesus promised if we'll keep our focus on him, he will deliver us, because he is our deliverer. Amen. And there's something. He said, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Hey, in my Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you. But I go and prepare a place for you, that where I am, you may come also. And we're stressing because we're looking past Jesus and we're seeing the problems of our life starting to dissolve. We're seeing our freedoms being taken away. We see now we can't travel unless we get some kind of credit card or some kind of a credential card, which all resembles the things we've been reading in Scripture. And so we're starting to stress. Don't stress. Look to Jesus. Keep your focus on Jesus. Keep talking to Jesus. Keep in relationship with you. He'll comfort you. He'll tell you, child of mine, don't stress over this. It's going to be all right. The Word of God teaches us this. So we have to see that. So when Peter got out of the boat, he looked at Jesus, and he did a great job as long as he was looking at Jesus. But the moment he took his eyes off Jesus, what happened? He stopped looking at Jesus. He looked past Jesus and saw the troubles, saw the water. And he said to himself, fool, what are you doing out here walking on the water? And the Bible says he took his eyes off. He began to sing. Jesus asked the question. He said, Peter, where did you begin to doubt? Did you begin to doubt in the beginning of your walking on the water? Or did you doubt toward the end? Because in the beginning, you could have doubted there, but you didn't doubt because your focus point was on Jesus. Jesus is our beginning, and he's our very ending. When this salvation happened to me, I looked to Jesus. When this life one day will be over and I'm in the process of the transition of leaving out, I'm going to be looking to Jesus. Because he's the author and he's the finisher of my faith. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians, watch what it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10. And it says this very interesting. He says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. Wow. We're going to appear before Jesus? Exactly. Every one of us who are born again, who are saved. Every one of you that are saved and born again. Now, if you are not saved, you will not appear before the judgment seat of Jesus Christ. If you are not born again, you will not appear before the judgment seat of Jesus Christ. You will appear before the judgment seat of God. The judgment of God, the white throne judgment. How many know the white throne judgment is not the same as the judgment seat of Christ? You want to appear before the judgment seat of Christ. You do not want to appear before the white throne judgment, because that's for the unbeliever. That's for those who are reprobate and those who are outside. But the Bible teaches us we will all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every one of us may receive the thing done in his body. So it tells us exactly what's going to take place here. We're not standing before the judgment seat of Jesus Christ so that we can be judged about heaven or hell. We're standing before the judgment seat of Christ so that everyone may receive, watch this that word again, that everyone may receive the things done in his body. In his body means when you were living in the physical realm. And now you are no longer living in the physical realm. Either one or two things, you have either died and you have left your body and you're present with the Lord, or second, the rapture has taken place and you've been caught up to meet him before the judgment seat of Christ. Isn't that amazing? This is going to happen in our future, man. This is exciting to understand that if we just keep following the Lord, we just keep dealing with stuff. Don't worry about it. You're not going to deal with enough stuff to where it's going to be too much. You'll eventually get done with dealing with stuff. You'll eventually close your eyes in death and open your eyes in heaven. And you don't have to worry about that. Just hang in here. Don't give up in the midst of your troubles. So he says that everyone may receive it, things done in his body according to that which he have done, whether it be, watch this word, good or bad. Good or bad. You're going to receive a reward for things you have done, either good or bad. Now that means that you're going to get, you know, if it's bad stuff you kind of done, I don't think it'll be, you know, the slap around, beat up, the bad stuff, but I think it'll be the kind of stuff that God, Jesus will say to you, I just want to ask you, why? Why did you live like that during this phase of your life? What were you going through? What were you thinking? Now remember what I told you about God. God never asks a question he doesn't already have the answer. Okay? So I was just laughing at my wife because her phone went off and my phone goes off sometimes in meetings. She goes, turn your phone off. All right, there it goes. And King David, but King David, and then she was acting like she wasn't doing like. King David viewed the Lord as his present strength. How many understand that? When King David was going through some things and he had some battles he was going through, he was viewing the Lord God as his strength. Amen. And all that stuff. Somebody help her with that phone, all right? And deliverance from all the troubles he had to face. David had problems, David had troubles, and David was looking to God. He was looking to the Lord to be his helper and to help him. The Bible says in the book of Psalms 144, just turn there. Psalms 144, verse 1 and verse 2. And this is what he says. Blessed be the Lord, my strength. David recognized in the midst of all of his failure, in the midst of all of his rebellion, in the midst of all of his disobedience, he still recognized, God, I need you. Isn't that what we have to do? We have to really look and understand that no matter how perfect we think we are, we're still flawed, and because we're still flawed, we need God's help. And then sometimes we fail, and if we fail, we just get up and dust the dust off our knees, ask God to forgive us, and go forward. And so the word teaches us that David said, blessed be the Lord, my strength, which teaches. Now, I love this word because he said he teaches my hands to war. Why would God teach your hands to war? Because God expects you to fight through this thing. God doesn't expect you to roll over and just let the devil have his way with your life and just say, well, I can't help myself. No, God expects you to fight. God will teach you how to be a fighter. And there's nothing like becoming a good fighter until you get a good beating. Isn't that true? I mean, this guy was jacking me up, man, and I was ready to go home, and I was crying, mama, and go home. My dad said, no, get back in there. I said, no, he's stronger than me. My dad said, you get back in there. He said, either you go out there, you beat him, or I'm going to beat you. I feared daddy. I went out there and beat that poor boy. I'm telling you, they thought I was crazy after I beat him so bad, because nothing like teaching you how to fight than being in the midst of a battle. You may get hit once and you think, my God, I don't want to get hit, but that's all there is to a hit. Wait a minute, I can hit too. And you begin it. So God was teaching David through the things he had to go through. David, despite your failures, I'm going to teach you, David, how to fight. And despite all of David's problems and all of his sins, God was still able to get victories through David. Just despite all your failures, my failures, our failures, God can still get victories through us if we don't stop fighting and we stay focused on the Lord and know that the Lord is our deliverer no matter what we have to go through. Thank God for going through things, because when you go through things, it sure helps you. It humbles you. I don't know about you, but when I thought I could never fall or I could never trip over this, or I never could do that, I never would say that. And when I said that, I said, Lord, why? And the Lord said, because you're not as strong as you thought you were. Humbled me. And then I was able to learn, well, teach me how to overcome it. And then God began to teach my fingers how to fight and do war. You see? And so he says here, and my fingers to fight. He says in verse 2, my goodness and my fortress, my high tower and my deliverer, my shield, and he in whom I trust, he subdueth my people under me. Now understand this thing that he gives to us here about the Lord being our deliverer. He teaches us here in the Word of God that he will subdue the people. That means he will conquer. Jesus will conquer the forces and exert his superior power over the devil. He says, I want to be with you. What did Paul the Apostle say to the church? He said, greater is he that's inside of you than he that's in the world. I'm more than a conqueror. How do you become more than a conqueror? You become more than a conqueror because the one that's fighting for you is fighting for you, and you don't have to do anything except to know that the battle is the Lord's, and the battle does not belong to you and I. So we need to stop stressing over somebody else's battle. Glory. All right. So then the word subdue, it means also to oppress or to crush or to sink this person. Now, the Bible prophesies in Genesis that he will crush the head of the devil. Jesus will crush the head. And thank God he did, because on the cross of Calvary, Jesus said some words that were very powerful. Jesus said, it is finished. He wasn't just talking about the salvation for human race. He was talking about the devil's ability to ever enslave you ever again if you will keep your eyes focused on him. He said, it is finished. He defeated the devil. He crushed Satan's head there. And we thank God for the victory, for the blood that Jesus gave to us. Jesus is identified in a number of places, but he's identified as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. What does that mean? That means you're the superior one. You're the king over all kings. You're the Lord over all lords. So whatever Lord, you know, whatever Lord you find, Lord El Chapo or whatever, he's Lord over him. How many hear what I'm saying? Well, I'm the Lord of death. I'm the Lord of disaster. Well, the Lord Jesus is Lord over you. I have the power to destroy you. Well, you might have the power to destroy, but he has greater power to keep me. Amen. You see, and with others, we begin to replace and focus point on Jesus, that no matter what I have to go through, no matter what I have to deal with, Jesus will sustain me and keep me and help me to get through it. I wish I had a Baptist church up in here. Man, I'm telling you, if we had a Baptist church, it'd be all over this place. Amen. You know, the Bible says, in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 14 through verse 16, and he says in these three verses of scripture, that thou keep this commandment which without spot, unrebukable, unto the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He tells us to keep his commandment. He tells us to stay in sync with him, keep focused, stay right, live holy, do what you have to do, obey him, looking to Jesus Christ one day. Then he says in verse 15, that which in his times he will shew who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. This potentate is the supreme master. He is the master over all things. He's the superior one. And that he is the ruling one. He is the conquering king. Jesus is not just, he's not any longer a baby in a manger. The world wants to keep us focused on Jesus being in the manger, or religion wants to keep us focused on Jesus on the cross. But I'm going to tell you two things happen. He's no longer a baby in the manger, and he's no longer on the cross. He is risen from the dead. And because he lives, we can live also. So we got to stop focusing that Jesus is being this just on the cross or some baby on Christmas time. He is conquering king. He's the master of the universe. He's my king. He's your king. He's the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, the master of the universe. He's the supreme. I mean, he is everything. He's all encompass of everything, and we are in him. He says in verse 16, who only hath immortality. What is he saying? He's saying that nobody else has immortality. You're not going to find immortality at the fountain of youth. You're not going to find it in vitamins. You're not going to find it in eating perfectly. We have perfect skin and perfect weight. And yes, you're going to perfectly die one day. And then we get surprised. Well, he died of a heart attack. He ran 15 miles a day. Yeah, and he still died of a heart attack. You see, because the only one who gives immortality is Jesus Christ. You want a fountain of youth? Look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of life. He is the one. He says, the immortality, who dwelling in light, which no man can approach unto, and whom no man have seen, nor can see, to whom be honor and power everlasting. Amen. Amen. David understood this, that the Lord is Lord. He is Yahweh. or he is Yahweh Mahati. I think I said that right. Yahweh Mahati, which means the Lord who is our deliverer. And so when David saw him there, he saw him as his deliverer. David not only recognized that, but he also recognized that he was his strength. He was his goodness. He was his provision. He was his fortress. He was his high tower, as well as being the Lord who is his deliverer. And I want you to understand something today, that God gives us a scripture that gives us identity of who Jesus Christ is. And I want you to have this tonight, and I want you to really focus on that and keep your focal point on Jesus Christ. And that is this, Psalms 50, looking at verse 15. Call upon me in the day of trouble, and that's what he says, and I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me. He said, if you'll call upon him, who do you call upon? I mean, who when you're in trouble, do you call upon Jesus? Or do you call upon others? Or you call upon discouragement? You call upon pity when you're in trouble? Call upon Jesus. And then Isaiah, the 65th chapter, looking at one verse, verse 24. And listen to what he says here. I love this because it shows the response of God to the church, to the people of God, and to his people Israel. He says in Isaiah 65, 24, and it shall come to pass that before they call, somebody say before they call, he said, before you call, I will answer. Isn't that something how God says, before you call, I will answer, and while they are yet speaking, I will hear them. So that means before I call, I'm getting ready to say, and before I can say, Father, he's already showed up. And before I can say, Lord, I need you to heal, and he's already healed me. Oh, come on, somebody. He's talking about people who have their eyes and their hearts focused on Jesus. Not focused on the world. Not focused on problems. Not focused on politicians. Focused on Jesus Christ. Lord, we look to you, the author and finisher of our faith. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a praise clap. Let's give God glory. Let's thank God for his mercy upon our lives. Amen. Stand to your feet if you would. God bless you. It's a rainy night. Thank you for coming out and being with us in the rain. Those of you that are at home and you didn't come because either you're living too far or maybe you don't drive in the rain, we love you and we thank God that you're able to tune in with us. May God bless you. And I hope that the message has really encouraged you and has put you into another position of learning that the Lord Jehovah Mahate is our deliverer. He is the one who delivers us from all things. Amen. And oh, Father God, I pray for your people. I pray for the anointing upon them, Father God, that there would be strength and there would be power placed upon their life, that they would be able, Father God, not to fall, not to fail, but to look to you, the author, finisher of our faith, and to keep our focal point on you, Jesus, even in the midst of our own failures, that we keep looking to you for forgiveness and for healing and deliverance. Lord Jehovah Mahate, we thank you, Father God. We ask God for the anointing in this place right now to just cover your people, cover their families tonight. And just, people of God, receive it right now. Just receive it by faith. I cover you with this anointing. The Lord Mahate, he is our deliverer. He's your deliverer. Don't be afraid of the world. Don't be afraid of world events. Don't be afraid of these things to come. The end is not yet. God has his hand. But Jesus could come anytime. We don't know when he can come. There are really no signs of his coming except he said, I will come one day. And we know that. Now, I know there are some signs, but we know there are two types of comings. To the end of the world when he comes and touches the base, and other time when he comes just for his people. So be part of that first one when he comes in that first catching away.
Thank you for joining us online. Here's Pastor Miller with the prayer of salvation.
His name, if you're watching today, you're watching tonight, or wherever you're watching from, you must make Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life. You must ask his forgiveness. It doesn't matter how much sin you have done. It doesn't matter what type of sins you've been involved in. God loves you. He can forgive anybody and cleanse you from anything. Amen. Why don't you pray this prayer with me if you're watching, or if maybe you're here today, tonight, pray this prayer with me. Say, Heavenly Father, I confess that I am a sinner. Please forgive me and save me from my sins. I believe in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give God praise. Let's give God glory. Yeah. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. I'm all fired up. God bless you. I'm all fired up for you. And if you are fired up and you want to go, if it's not raining out there, if it's not pouring down, I'm going to be out there at the beach. I've got some pastors. I met some pastors yesterday. Had a pastor's meeting, prayer meeting. And now some of them want to know where we're going to be, Ocean Beach. I said, hey, we're going to be down there. I told them, bring their bands, bring their tambourines, bring their horns. If you got a trumpet, come on, trumpeters. If you got a guitar and you can play it somewhat, you play better than me. Come on out there, and we're going to have a good time if you can make it. If you can't make it, God bless you. If it's pouring down, raining, of course, we probably won't be there. But if it's just cold, I'll be there. I'll be there trying to win souls for Jesus. Amen. Until next time, God bless you all. Bye-bye.
Thank you for joining us online. We hope that you continue to worship with us. For additional information about our church, jump online at WLWC.org. And continue to follow us on social media. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thank you, and God bless.